Hello everyone, I'm Advait from Kazob, and I just like to say welcome to everybody who's taken the time out to come on, and also hi Ravikant for coming here and spending some time for us.
Thank you.
Okay, so for the people who are seeing a webinar by us for the first time, just to give you an idea of what we do. So we are a career development company in which we are trying to bridge the gap between education and the industry by interviewing people from the industry and basically getting an industry view of the subject that you're probably studying in college or you're working and you're interested in that particular subject. So today we're going to cover the topic of the different careers in supply chain management. And we've got around 105 registrations from more than 15 engineering colleges all across India. So I'm really grateful for that. And today what we're going to be discussing basically is number one, what is supply chain management? Number two, what are the different work streams, the different functions and the different job roles that you can actually pursue in supply chain management? And number three, we are going to be talking about warehousing and transportation because those are two prominent cost components in the supply chain. So it's important that you get an idea about that. And then we're going to be talking about the key skills that are required by a supply chain professional to actually succeed in the industry. And then in the end, we'll have a Q&A session. But I'll just like to tell the audience that that don't wait for the end of the webinar to send in your questions. Just send in your questions as and when you get them. Okay, and we'll also be doing two polls during the webinar. You know, so we will be doing two polls, and then we will also be sharing the results of that poll with the audience, so that even you, the audience can get an idea of what your peers are thinking. You know, so it's not only about say what the professional is thinking, but also what you are thinking. So with that, let me introduce Ravikant. Ravikant is the CEO of the Progress Group India, and I think he'll be better at talking about his profile and about TPG. So over to you, Ravi.
Yeah, thanks, Advait. Thank you very much. And thanks a lot for all the 100 odd participants or the students who are there eagerly waiting to listen what is different in supply chain. So supply chain being such a vast field, it always gives a challenge about what is supply chain, what are the different components of supply chain and other things. And by the end of this presentation, what I would like to give you an idea is about what supply chain looks like from a professional side of it, from an industry side of it, rather than from what you have seen from an academic side of it. Yep. So I'll just share a screen and start with a brief bio of myself, and then we'll go into the supply chain aspects.
Okay, so, great.
Yeah, sorry guys, I think we lost 2 minutes there. Okay, so I hope you're able to see broadly. So like I said, I was not born as a supply chain professional. I've been in the supply chain industry for the last 15 years. Largely in the retail industry, working with two of the India's biggest retail companies, Reliance and Future Group. I worked with Future Group for almost 13 years, and then 2-3 years with Reliance. Over the last, initially I started my career in engineering projects, working on setting up factories and other things. And over the last 5-10 years, I've been able to work on implementing automation technologies for retail industry in logistics areas. So working on the operation side of it, working on the design side, building bigger warehouses. So when you say warehouses, we typically think of godowns, 10,000, 5,000 square feet. I started my career with managing a 10,000 square feet warehouse. And 3 years back, I ended up building India's biggest distribution center, which is a 4 lakh square feet warehouse in Nagpur. So that's the journey which I have seen is typically the journey of the transformation of the supply chain in India, and which has brought to fore the subject of supply chain, because that was not traditionally taught. So that's a brief about my profile. We can discuss this later. So as we move on, we will discuss about some aspects. So here is a rough agenda. We'll discuss about supply chain and logistics, which is and its evolution in the Indian context, the challenges in the warehousing, challenges in transportation. These are the two broad subjects of supply chain. Attributes of what we call good supply chain management professionals. Then means companies like us, what do we see in the supply chain professionals? What do we want you people like to be? You know, what are the skill sets we look for? SCM as a career option in the new emerging world. And then we'll take some questions. And we'll have a brief about our company itself. So now we move on to the supply chain and logistics, a continuous evolution. So I hope you're able to see the picture.
It's
a picture of a retail store. Yeah. So it's a picture of a retail store, the what you call typically in the Western language, you call the mom and pop store, because it was managed by the families. And it still is managed by families in India and everywhere else. So the question is, with the retail changing, if you see now, from there to we have come to the malls. With the retail changing, how the supply chain has changed is what is the point of discussion. So you are from mom and pop stores, you had very big malls coming in, and then now the advent of e-commerce. So all these three requires very, very different types of supply chain. And the need for servicing these formats has what evolved the supply chain itself. So that is why we kind of changing the trying to see how retailers change their supply chain. Now, logistics is there. Logistics is there everywhere. If you see, I think the photograph, what you see is a queue outside a Jack and Jones, Vera Moda bestseller store before the sale starts. Now, before the sale starts, is a queue there. As you go in, after, let's say, an hour or so or 2 hours, you run out of all the merchandise which is running on discount. Why does it happen? How does it happen? How does the merchandise which is on sale reach there on the stands? And after it is finished, how does it get replenished? That is a discussion about logistics. So logistics is about the journey of the product from the warehouses all the way to the stores. And if you see another photograph, it's about some kind of an Amazon kind of delivery, Amazon, Flipkart, Snapdeal is what you've seen, what you are very well aware of. Guys on the bike delivering small packages all around the houses. Yep. Now, an adaptive supply chain, in order to serve the continuous changing demand, the field of logistics needs to be very adaptive. So if you see, from factories where it is produced, it is carried on different modes, air, rail, ship, and then to the warehouses where it is stocked. It's picked as per the requirement, again through small trucks, it goes to the retail stores. Now, how does it changing with e-commerce? Probably you need to ship it directly. From factories, it gets shipped directly because there's no shop there now. It's directly going to the customer place. So from warehouses, you can directly ship it to the customer. From factory, you can ship it to the customer, or even from the stores for that matter. Today, there is a concept of multi-channel retailing where you do this e-commerce deliveries from the stores as well. Now, let's take a pause and see how the warehousing per se, warehousing, which is a big component of supply chain, has evolved over the last few years. You are very familiar with this kind of godowns, and this kind of evolved to what you see the next picture, which is kind of decent looking warehouses where with the metal handling equipment, with racks and all things. And this got the next stage of the evolution was the big distribution centers, which is 1 lakh square feet, 2 lakh square feet, 3 lakh square feet. If you see the picture here, is probably a 4 or 5 lakh square feet distribution center of one of the big retailers or the one of the big e-commerce giants. And then from there to huge logistics parks, where you have multiple warehouses, multiple these things. With earlier, the question used to be, how many dock doors do we have? 2 dock doors, 3 dock doors in a warehouse. Now it's a question of 40 dock doors or 50 dock doors in a warehouse, because time to transfer the materials from the truck to the warehouse or the other way around needs to be handled, and needs to be handled very efficiently. Yep. So now let's take a holistic view of the supply chain and logistics. What all does it include? Supply chain starts from suppliers, to factories, you supply the raw material to the factories. From factories, the finished product moves to the warehouses. The warehouses stock it and then redistribute it through different modes to the various channels of retailing. It could be general trade, it could be big box retailers, it could be direct e-commerce. So that's what the last channel is basically. And then the last leg of the supply chain, which is the customer. So the question is, what is supply chain? The supply chain is all of these things. There is work in supply chain across all of these things. There's a raw material planning there. There's a factory production planning and this thing, which many of you read in production planning. There is a way of warehouse management. There is a transportation part of it, and then the channel management part of it, and the customer service management part of it. Overarching all this, what you call the verticals of supply chain, is what you call the planning function. So S&OP and supply chain planning. What is S&OP? Sales and operational planning. So you convert your sales into operational plans. You convert back into saying, if I'm doing X amount of sales, what is the Y amount of product which I need to service, and therefore the Y amount of product needs to be serviced. How much I need to stock, and therefore how much I need to produce, falling all the way back to how much I need to source raw material so that I can keep the factories churning and the warehouses moving on the plan. On the bottom side, there are specific examples of capability development, organization design, system selections. You have different systems across these different verticals. You have supply planning, we have different tools for that. You have demand planning, you have different tools for that. In warehouses, you have warehouse management system, which is a different system in itself. Then in distribution, you have got transportation management system, which is to manage the transportation part of it. And then channel management, the customers, you have a lot of CRM softwares today managing the customer requirements and the customer expectations. So these are all systems which require for each of this. Then there's a program management across all verticals. You have KPIs, key performance indicators for each of this parameters. You have strategy overlapping all of this, and then the product cycle management, which cuts across all the legs of supply chain for the product which is being supplied. Yeah. Now, what is the ultimate goal of working here? The ultimate goal is to save two things: money and time. So either it's time to market, what we call in our terms at times is called time to market and cost to market. So we have to minimize these two things. All our optimization, all our solutions are with these two things in mind. Reduce cost to market, that is save money, and reduce time to market, which also in a way reflects back in saving money. So challenges in warehousing, let's understand this. Challenges in warehousing is, while we saw in the evolution of the warehouses, go down, changing to distribution centers, where and then distribution center logistics park, lot of many other things which we see in pictures, is still not changed. For example, we don't have warehouses which are bigger than 5 lakh square feet. If you go to US, if you go to China, even if you go to Hong Kong, Malaysia, which are not so developed countries, you will see warehouses which are 7 lakh square feet, 10 lakh square feet, 15 lakh square feet single distribution centers. Now you don't have that kind of distribution centers in India. India is a different market, but there are other challenges around which, because of which this could not be implemented. Because there are not bigger distribution centers, you don't have a very high level of automation, because automation requires capex. Capex requires economies of scale. To be there, you need to have bigger distribution centers. So you have very high-end technologies called pick to light, put to light, high-speed sortation, cross-belt sorters, tilt tray sorters, robots, shuttle systems, all of these. But these are kind of either one or two examples in India, or almost not there kind of thing. Now, why are we lagging in terms of adapting high-end technology? Okay. So like I said, the key issue is the lack of big distribution center. Because when you talk of technology, when you saw those sorters or the items or the light and all those things, they're pretty expensive. If they are expensive, I should be able to use them for 24 hours a day. I should be able to use them for many other this thing. And it works. The economies of scale work only if you have one or two of them. You can't have 20 of them. Now, because if you see the cause is a complex track structure and poor logistics infrastructure. The problem is we have got 29 states, 30 states. States keep increasing, and because of the way the taxation is there, it is very inefficient for us to ship across the state. So once you're shipping across the state, you end up paying CST, which is central sales tax, which is a total loss to the supplier and therefore to the customer at the end of the day. Having to save this 2% of the cost, you ended up having 20 distribution centers or 30 distribution centers. And because of which all the distribution centers are so small. Now, another reason for having small distribution centers, many distribution centers, so to say, is because of poor logistics infrastructure. When I say logistics infrastructure, I'm talking about the transportation infrastructure. Now, if the transportation infrastructure is not great, the predictability for it, that it will reach me exactly in 24 hours, it will reach me in 36 hours, is very, very low. Because the predictability is low, I end up storing safety stock. And the moment I stock it more, that means I need stocking points at all these locations. So therefore, there are many warehouses, primarily because the tax mandate that. The other is, even if the tax was not a problem, the poor logistics and transportation infrastructure mandates me to have more distribution centers. The more distribution center means each distribution center is smaller in size. Therefore, I'm not able to have economies of scale, and therefore I cannot put a lot of automation there and bring in efficiencies. Yeah. Now, what are the challenges in transportation? So if you see a very high level view of the GDP, so our GDP is around 1.97 billion as compared to US, which is 1.9 trillion. Okay. Now, our logistics cost as a percentage of GDP is anywhere estimated to be between 12% to 14%. And out of that, transportation is the bulk of it. If you see, 35% is transportation. You see a lot of percentage in services, but that's a lot of it is in services is also part of transportation. And some part of it is inventory holding cost, which should be part of the warehousing. So if you broadly divide this into warehousing and transportation. Now, if you see transportation, road is 50% of it. So there's a 9% which is express is actually part of road. Express actually follows road network. And then the railroad and this thing is very, very less. So we are depending on our road network for 50% of the overall transportation which we do. Now, what are the current challenges? Current challenges, if you talk of all the three nodes, the road is very high cost because obviously transportation by rail is much more efficient because it's a bigger mode of transportation, but that is really restricted in India to commodities like, you know, minerals, salt, grains, food grains, and etc. And it's only the road which comes in. Even in road, our truck sizes are typically very small because of the road conditions, because of the way our road trucks need to the customer's place and all those things. So we end up paying high cost, high transit time, with a lot of uncertainties and with a lot of check posts and at every state, we end up the time transit time also increases a lot. Now, rail, I said, it has been largely limited to commodities with high transit time. Typically, the transit time of rail should have been lower. Now, why is it high? It is high because it is actually piggybacking on the passenger traffic. So every time you see a passenger train coming in, the goods train gets sidelined and the passenger train goes ahead. So if we really are serious about rail infrastructure boost, then there's something called dedicated freight corridors. So on this, only the freight trains run. So that is how this need to be done. Plus, in India, the passenger traffic is 80% of the load, but it actually earns only 20%. So the funds are allotted for this, whereas freight is actually, as an income, gives 80% to the Indian Railways, but what it gets in terms of budgeting is only 20%. So that has to change. Air, for example, air is now the third, but it's always going to be an expensive proposition to send by air, but next day deliveries and all couriers will always follow air. With the economy growing, we kind of use air as a backup, and there will never be a primary transport mechanism. So road needs improvement. Rail needs to support the road if our logistics infrastructure has to improve. Yeah. Now, what are the possible solutions? We're discussing about road, GST. All of you might have heard what GST is, goods and service tax, common goods and service tax across the country. India will be one market, not 29 market, different markets for sellers. If that happens, you will have no check post typically, stopping and checking and everything. So therefore, you'll have faster transit times. The road infrastructure getting better means bigger trucks, standard body trucks, more organized players coming into picture. So there is a study which says that only less than 5% of the transportation market in India is actually organized. So with the more organized players coming in, you'll have more money there to be fed into this transportation industry. Better driver facilities, borderless transportation, and you know, trucks can go from anywhere to anywhere. Today, if you ask a truck which is flying between Mumbai and Delhi to go to Delhi to Calcutta, it will not go because the driver is uncomfortable traveling on a new route, because a new route brings with it its own complexities. Now, as GST comes in, there is no check post and all, we believe that will go away. Rail infrastructure has to support the road, and that can only happen if you develop the railway ecosystem to handle e-commerce logistics. And we have dedicated freight corridors. So people who have seen in US and all, the freight trains typically carry four containers, one on top of another, across the cross country. Now in India, it's because we piggyback on the passenger load, we can't do more than two containers because it will hit the electrification. Most of the railway lines are electrified now. Airports, obviously, we need to ramp up the airports because of the economy and because the e-commerce is going to be a big thing, and e-commerce will always require some, you know, last minute deliveries and all. Yeah. So that was a brief about what is the supply chain landscape in India. Now, as we see, we have tried to see how the warehousing landscape and the transport landscape has changed over the years. If it is not changed to the best, why it has not changed? And last but not the least, if it has to change to good, what all things need to change? We discussed that. Having discussed that, let's try to see what are the attributes we look for good supply chain professionals who want to make a career in supply chain. Now, just to give heart to all of you guys who are what you call non-industrial engineers or non-supply chain core subjects. I myself am not a supply chain professional by education. So I did my BA, then did my MBA, went into engineering projects, and then accidentally came into retail when retail was just starting. So, and then from then on, I have been in retail logistics, working on the supply chain field. So it is basically a commonsensical thing. And for every commonsensical subject to come to the fore, the question which needs to be asked is why? You should not be shy of asking why in supply chain. And you need to have analytical bent of mind. So creativity is important, but here analytics is very, very important. So you have to do this analytics and then come to creative solutions for that. Now, one of the other attributes which we look for in candidates is your obsession or your this thing with perseverance, which is to do with the process improvements. If there is something there right now, how do I make it better? That is a very, very important attribute of the supply chain professionals. Team skills, obviously, I think that is something which is very common to a lot of other this thing, other than, you know, hardcore IT, I would say, where, you know, you can be still an individual contributor and still make it very good. But otherwise, a lot of other fields do require team skills and a multidisciplinary approach, because it does not only teach you supply chain, but it teaches you whichever industry you're working for. You're working for logistics, for FMCG industry, for electronic industry, for anything. For example, if you see the Amazon services, almost every product. So you get to, so this is a multidisciplinary approach. It actually overarches all the, product categories, all the industries which you see in day-to-day life. And obviously, in all this chaos, you have to stay calm, because things have to change, things have to improve. Now, what are the, having understood what are the attributes, which is largely with do with intuitiveness, to ask why, when, how, and then discussing about and doing then that and giving a solution. What are the career options you can, you know, choose? So there are career options in on the supply side, which is procurement analyst, strategic sourcing, sourcing managers. There's a procurement strategy. There's a category manager, what you call, what you hear in retail. Then there's a supplier relationship manager. You manage the relationship with the suppliers. All of these are in itself are complete what you call careers in themselves. Then you come to factories. You could be process engineers. You could be a factory supervisors. You could be what you call continuous improvement or node of excellence kind of a thing. You could be line managers. You could be working the quality assurance department. All of these, in one way or the other, are linked with supply chain. Warehouses. So warehouses, so career in warehouses is coming to the fore only in the last 5-7 years. When I started my career in warehousing in 2001, people with BMBA never used to come to warehouses. Nobody. Typically, people with BMBAs from NITI and other things would be in demand planning, supply planning, in factories, production planning, right? And on the customer end of it. But working in warehouses was not a career at all for good professionals. Now it is. You've seen the warehouses. It's bigger than factories. The investment is as big as factories. And they keep running all the time, 24 hours a day. So it requires specialists. It requires process improvement engineers. It requires operation managers. It requires warehouse managers. And then after it leaves the warehouses, there's something called a distribution, which is a transportation, what we call in simple language. So there you need to schedule the trucks, schedule the deliveries. You need to do vendor management because typically the trucks are outsourced. You need to manage these vendors. Yeah? And then you need to do the contract management because it's mostly third-party outsourced, right? Then you do need to do channels, channel management, order management, how the orders are coming in. You need to manage accounts. MIS is a very, very big thing in all of these because analytics is very important. And then the customer demand planning, if you see, we discuss about it. So largely, it was only the first two and the last one where people used to work in supply chain. The middle ones are what has got developed over the last 2-3 years. And that's the core of supply chain. That's where the biggest cost is. That's where the biggest work is happening in the last 5 years. And I believe the next decade is going to happen. And GST is going to give a good impetus to that. Obviously, there is something called a planning part of it, which overarches on each of these horizontals or verticals, what you may call. And then the HR aspect of it, talent management, software system aspect of it, program management of it, and the product cycle management. So I hope you got a good view of what all kind of careers are possible in this. So traditionally, like I said, there were the first two and the last one were what people focused on. But now the warehousing and distribution is something which has come to the fore.
So Ravi, can we just go back to that particular slide of the different career options, because we've put up a poll right now, you know, to kind of get an idea of what the viewers, you know, like what are they most passionate about in the supply chain. So now, is that warehousing, transportation, or procurement, or something else? You know, so if the viewers, if you can just put up your answers in the poll that has come below your video screen, it would be great. And then and then we'll actually share share a summary of the answers with you guys. So so go ahead, Ravi, you can continue.
Yeah, thanks. So yeah, so so that you remember, it starts from suppliers, goes to the factories, comes to the warehouse, gets distributed, and then there are various modes of channels through which they just distribute, and to finally to the end customers. Now, in terms of verticals, there is FMCG, there is retail, e-commerce, auto and spare parts, pharma, commodities, software and technology, consulting, and 3PL. So if you see, these are the, while on one side you saw about what are the function of supply chain you're working on, there could be industry in which you also could be working on. You could be working in demand planning, for an FMCG industry, or you could be working in demand planning for a retail industry, or in e-commerce, or a pharma for that matter. So you could be working on the procurement side for each of these industries as well. You could be working on the system side for each of these industries. Broadly, these are the, you know, so this is it's kind of a matrix. You have functions and then you have verticals. So for example, the company which I represent, the Progress Group, is in the bottom center one, which is called consulting. So we do consulting for only for supply chain, typically across all these verticals. So there are 3PL companies which provide services for all these verticals. So, and there are technology services services companies which provide systems and technologies for all these industries. Yep. So with that, I think we come to a close, wrap up. I'll say we discussed about the evolution of supply chain in India. Then we discussed about what changed and what did not change, why it did not change. And then we discussed about what is the key to make these changes. We discussed about GST, we discussed about ramping the rail infrastructure, we discussed about ramping up the road infrastructure and other things. And then we came to career aspects of what attributes do we look for in good supply chain professionals, what are the career options in supply chain. And then we'll, before we really go to the questions part of it, a very quick overview of what we do so that you get an idea about this thing. We are a supply chain consultancy, and we are a part of Crimson & Co, which is a UK-based consultancy. We have offices in US, Sao Paulo, Singapore, Australia, and India. We work across, this slide might look familiar to you because that's our scope of services. We work across all the aspects of supply chain. In specific services, we work on supply chain strategy, which is what you call a network design. How many warehouses should you have? How many, what kind of warehouses should you outsource or should you not outsource? What kind of inventory management philosophy is your? These are all what you call the strategic level solutions. Then you have benchmarking and best practices. Then we do work on the facility and operations design, which is typically called in simple language, the warehouse design, warehouse technology, automation, integrated material handling systems kind of thing. So the Amazon distribution center, which you saw, probably will end up designing that, what parts should be where, what racks should be where, what product needs to be kept in what systems and all kind of thing. And then standard industrial engineering thing, time and motion studies through video analytics and all those things. So we work at a 30,000 feet level on strategy. We are level right on the ground floor, analyzing the time and motion studies for all the workmen. Some clients, we have worked in India. India would be of interest to you guys. We have worked in India with Reliance, Blue Dart, Amazon, Wildcraft, good 3PL companies, and big retailers like Future Group and Reliance. Yeah. So I think that's what it is. So that's the end of the presentation. I think I'll open it to the for questions.
Yeah, great.
Do you have any questions?
Yeah, we do. We actually do have quite a few. So Ravi, actually the first question is from me, you know.
Should I stop the screen share right now or is it okay?
Yeah, go ahead. You can stop that. You can stop.
I'll close the presentation, I think, right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, great. So can you talk a little bit more about why is it that, you know, in India, automation is not yet picking up, and why, say, in a country like the US, it is so widely used?
Okay. Very quickly, automation needs a lot of CapEx. Now, CapEx needs to have an ROI, what you call a return on investment. Now, ROI comes from two things. One is economies of scale, and whether you are able to offset it with people. Now, our labor cost, or what you call the people cost, is 1/10 of what we have in US. In US, you have typically minimum wages starts from around $10 to $11 an hour, whereas in India, it's $1 an hour, typically. If that's the thing, you are never able to justify to a board or to a CFO the kind of investment you're making, because just by a people trade-off, it doesn't work out. So unless you're really working with the philosophy that I need automation because I need to future-proof my warehouse, and this thing, it doesn't really work out. And like I said, because of the state structure and all, we have lot many warehouses. And a lot many warehouses by default means small warehouses, low volume. When you're putting out automation, you want to sweat the assets a lot. To sweat the assets, you need to really churn out a lot from there. So therefore, you need to have bigger distribution centers to be able to make a sense of that capex. So I think that's the core answer to it. Why is automation not very popular in India as compared to US? Two reasons. One, you don't have bigger warehouses. And the reason why you don't have bigger warehouses is the tax structures and other things. And the cost of people.
Okay, great.
Yep.
Okay, so for the people who joined late, there's a question tab that's below the video. So if you have any questions, do send in those questions and we'll try to answer as many as possible. So Ravi, like while we are waiting for more questions to come in, how about we have a look at the answers of the first poll?
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, so I'll just share my screen so you can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there you have it. So we've got procurement being the highest at around 24%. Right. And then we've got planning, warehousing, and others all equally at 18%. So your thoughts on that? Are you surprised that this is the trend or anything?
No, I'm not at all surprised. So this is the results which is expected, because that goes on to show that professionals like us have a long way to go in terms of making warehousing and transportation a more sexy field, you know, what you call. So career, somebody who's passing out of a supply chain would really not go into transportation, because when parents ask me, what are you going to do in a Amazon warehouse? He says, I'm going to do delivery, or I'm going to manage the delivery boys. It doesn't really look sexy, right? So, if my parents would have, our parents would have seen the videos of that distribution center which we have seen, and that kind of distribution centers become common in India, you know, that perception about warehousing, because warehousing is still viewed in India as godowns. Wo godam chalana hai, something like that, you know.
Right.
Unless that changes, and that will change only with time and with people seeing real results. And the same is with transportation. You know, until you see a transportation, you know, delivery guys or truck drivers sitting in a dirty truck, in a dirty environment, these things are not going to change. So therefore, I think, so the lowest percentage if you see is for transportation,
right?
Which is not a surprise, because that's one of the worst industries to work for right now.
Right.
But if you know, in US and all, people who have been in US, people, I think there are few people who are studying MS in US, they will know that the truck drivers in US get paid around $60,000 an annum, which is probably higher than what people get after studying engineering and this thing as a starting salary, right?
Right. Okay.
So unless we come to that thing, we have to work a lot. People like us have to work a lot to make these two aspects of the supply chain as glamorous as, as other things are.
Right. So, so that's pretty interesting, because I think you said that the percentage of the overall cost that's occupied by transportation is 50%, right?
As part of the total supply chain cost, yes.
Yeah, so that's quite surprising. I mean, people who are going into supply chain, they don't yet know that there's so much scope in transportation, for example.
Actually, it's not 50%, it's actually 2/3. So typically, if you ask any supply chain professional and ask the ratio of warehousing to transportation, it's 1/3, 2/3. 1/3 is warehousing typically, and 2/3 is transportation. Because, you know, when high-end analytics happens, and the, you know, cost of services, it was a big thing, right? So inventory holding cost. Where do you put the inventory holding cost? Do you put it in warehousing or transportation?
Right.
Lot of the inventory holding cost is attributed to transportation, actually. Oh. Because I'm not confident of sending the materials at the right time. Mm-hmm. I hold safety stock. And that's what sells up my inventory holding cost.
Right. So, okay.
Yeah. So that's the that's the correlation with that. Yeah.
Okay, great. Okay, so let's take another question from the audience.
Please.
So you got Omkar asking, hello, sir, as we know, the technology of logistics, warehousing, etc. is moving towards complete automation. So what kind of qualities or skills should one develop to cope up with the future requirements?
Fantastic. So there are people who are interested in warehousing and warehousing automation. That's great to hear. So, okay, skill sets, nothing extraordinary. Like I said, you need to be inquisitive. You need to be analytical. I think these are the two things which are the core for that. Now, automation is not the end goal for a supply chain professional. When we are designing warehouses, when we are designing solutions, we don't do with the intent of doing automation. The intent is, like I said, reduce cost, reduce time.
Right.
Because time is money at the end of the day. So for that, whatever is required, we have to do. So there is a high-end automation which is happening. Yes. But India being India, the demographics being in such a manner, the density of the people being, the population density being such, it will never be equivalent of what you see in China or what you see in US, but it will be different. It will still need automation.
Right.
So you as students, if you're trying to work in that field, it's not important to have any special skill set. I'll give you an example. My example, for example, I started my career in a 10,000 square foot distribution center in Calcutta 15 years back in 2001. That warehouse had a simple racks, on ground storage, nothing. Now today, in 15 years of this journey, I have been able to design and run one of the biggest distribution centers in India, which is a 4 lakh square foot distribution center in Nagpur when I was working with Future Group, right? So you really don't need to have anything extraordinary with you. You need to have these two things, like I said, analytical skills and inquisitiveness to get to the right solution. I think those are the things there. You go and join Amazon, go and join Flipkart. The first job they will do is go to the warehouse floor and start picking along with the pickers. Mm-hmm. Meaning to you, but please understand that's your first step to probably design the bigger, very big distribution center. I started as a warehouse manager. I picked up cartons with my own hands. I've loaded my own trucks. And you will also have to do it. It doesn't demean your ability by any means for that matter. Mm-hmm. So if you are getting a chance to work in a distribution center or a fulfillment center of Flipkart or Snapdeal or Amazon, go ahead, grab that chance. Because now in 3 years' time, because you're engineers, you'll be promoted very fast. You'll become supervisors. You'll become managers. You'll start managing the facility. I've seen engineers with 10 years' experience managing a 1.5 lakh square foot distribution center, fulfillment center of Amazon. And that's what you want to be, right, after 15 years. And in that, when you start doing automation, you'll be the one who will be very key player in terms of defining what automation should be there, what should not be there, kind of thing. So that's your first step. If you get a chance to work on the shop floor, don't shy away from that.
Okay, great. I have a question. You know, how automation is, you know, like people still consider it as the in thing. Like, do you ever have any challenges, say with a client, you know, like who is so hell-bent on getting automation, you know, but the numbers are just not proving it, you know, so does that ever happen?
Yeah, it does happen. So typically till the numbers, clients have come with, because there are many other reasons for doing automation. You might be wanting to do automation because you want to be seen, because supply chain is only one side of the entire business, right? So the entire business wants to be seen in the eyes of the industry as the most upcoming one, let's say. Now, that the reason for automation could be to project the company in such a manner that it is always just the leading things kind of a thing. So it does happen typically, but when we put the numbers in front, the trade-offs are not there. Companies insist on it till they see the numbers, actually. Once you see the numbers, then the trade-offs are so different, then it doesn't work out. But yes, now things are not like that because there are bigger distribution centers and the economies of scale are coming in. So there are people like ITCs building mega distribution centers. There are people like Unilever who invested a lot. So all of them, but yes, the percentage of investment in there. So if there are 20 distribution centers, there are only one distribution center which is highly mechanized, something like that.
Okay.
But they are investing and they're trying to check the feasibility of these things, these technologies.
Okay, great. So we got another question. This one's from Prathamesh. And I want to ask the entire question because he's gone into real detail. But I'll just give you the gist of it. So basically, he is a procurement analyst in an MNC, and in his particular MNC, they've got a lot of parts coming in from China. So the number of parts is high, and even the distribution is really high. So they're distributing they have this manufacturing hub, and then from the manufacturing hub, they are distributing it all across the country. So is there any way in which he can use JIT or JIT, which is just in time, for for actually reducing the transportation cost?
It's very difficult to say it as a solution right now. Like I said, supply chain is about detail.
Right.
Okay. So we really have to see it. What products? Because if there are, let's say, 200,000 SKUs which you are importing, okay, JIT might be applicable for, let's say, 50,000 or let's say 10,000. Now we need to see the profile of those SKUs and then tag it. Isn't it? So it's not that if JIT is applicable, it can be applicable to all. So because certain products would be coming from China, it has a particular lead time. Certain products would be coming from India.
Right.
Supposing the warehousing is in your core factory is in Chennai, and a lot of suppliers were in Chennai itself. So whichever suppliers are supplying from Chennai, probably for those items, JIT can be a very simple. So why do you need to hold it? Because when you call the supplier, next day morning the products will be there. So you have a certainty to that.
Right.
So as long as you have a certainty, you can do what you call JIT, because just in time, I will get just in time for my package to be ready to be sent out to this thing.
Right.
But something is coming from China, it's very difficult to predict when exactly it will come. So therefore, you need to have that safety stock, because the customer orders, I still want to fulfill it, right?
Right.
So it is not a kind of a, single box solution. It needs to be customized for that particular product, for that particular customer kind of thing.
Okay, great. So while we're waiting for more questions to pour in, and actually we've just got around 10 minutes remaining, I've put up another poll. So this poll is asking the students or the viewers, which industry would they like to work in the most? So we've got a few options, such as FMCG, to retail, to consulting, transportation, and a few others. So let's see what they say. And while we're waiting for the responses, let's go into another question from the audience.
Okay,
so we've got a question from Nitin, who's asking that he's currently a procurement engineer in the oil and gas sector, and he wants to do his MS in industrial engineering.
Right.
So his concern is that since he's been a procurement engineer and it's a very streamlined job, he won't be able to work anywhere else in the supply chain. So do you have any thoughts on that? I know it's a bit of a career advice.
I have a lot of advice for that, because I have gone through this phases. So no problem. So Nitin, right? Yeah, Nitin, a very good question. So why do you think you will not be able to work anywhere? So it is not for you to it is for you to decide where you can work, because like I said, you're working in oil and gas. So commodity supply chain are very different than what you call consumer logistics supply chain. So consumer logistics is all retail, FMCG, e-commerce, and all these things is all consumer logistics. They're all small ones, small pieces. Commodity logistics, oil and gas, food grains, minerals, these are all what you call commodity logistics. So the scale of commodity logistics and the kind of problems which you have in this is very, very different than what you have in consumer logistics.
Okay.
Industrial engineering caters to all of this. So there is no reason why you could not do industrial engineering and then take a career choice of trying to work in a consulting or a 3PL. If you are really interested about operations, you can join in 3PL industry. Third-party logistics industry is doing warehousing and transportation. You can join FMCG industry. Because you think it's getting boring in the oil and very common, very streamlined job in the oil and gas, why don't you take a dip to the FMCG industry? So yes, often when you try to shift, nobody will give you a chance. But once you do industrial engineering as an MS or MBA kind of a thing from NITI and anywhere, then your career path opens up into other industries, both in the horizontals and the verticals. And there's, like I said, the only thing to success requires is your inquisitiveness and the analytical skill sets.
Right.
I myself, after doing MBA, went into engineering projects, because at that point of time, we had a sense of mind. Engineering was difficult to get into. So therefore, we thought it's very important that you work in engineering.
Right.
So after doing MBA, I went into engineering, worked for 6-7 years, and then I went to logistics. And still I'm here discussing with you all people about supply chain. So there's nothing stops you. Do industrial engineering, and that will open up your career options for so many industries and so many horizontals. Right. That will give you a very good chance, is what I say.
Okay. So actually, we have another question that's again to do with some career advice. So if you don't want to answer it, you can say you don't want to answer it.
That's fine.
Okay, so this question is from Vineha, and she's asking that I'm currently doing my master's in the US. What are the job opportunities when I get back? You know, so maybe you can just give, you know, like if you have had any experiences of people coming back from the US after doing their MS in industrial engineering.
Absolutely. I have two of my three key members. My second tier in my consultancy itself are ladies, and who have worked in supply chain, who have studied supply chain, one from Georgia Tech in US and another from Cranfield in UK. And they are working as part of our team in India. So they worked in US, came back to, yeah, absolutely. So one, there is no short of work as far as ladies are concerned. Please don't think supply chain is restricted to this thing. And my three senior consultants, two senior consultants are ladies and very good. They are very, very good. So therefore, there is nothing stopping you from thinking that you cannot get a career option. So when you come back, the career options are not only in consulting. You will get so many options in all these e-commerce companies, probably,
right,
where you can do planning, where you can do, you go to Amazon and you can see on the warehouse floor, fulfillment centers, people, ladies and men working around with laptops, planning and executing the orders and order fulfillment part of it. So there's a huge amount of scope. Now it's a glamorous as well as compared to what it was not 3-4 years back. So there should be nothing stopping you, and not in, you should not be getting worried about it all.
Okay, great. So we have time for just one more question. I have experience in purchase and contract management in consulting. Can the experience of the same in India be of value in US while seeking internships or jobs?
I think any experience is valid. So what you have to, so yes, the contracts, the type of contracts in India will be very different of the type of contracts in US. Mm-hmm. The kind of procurement strategies you would have worked on will be different there. But what is important when you highlight that experience is not the experience, but what that experience has brought into you. That is important.
Right.
So for example, because of the way you worked in contract management, supposing you analyzed a lot of contracts to see whether they were high on the KPIs, less on the KPIs and all those things. So that's what you do. That's what you need to highlight in your CVs. It's not about what the exact experience was, but what that experience developed, what you developed as a part of that experience is what you need to highlight in your CV when you're applying for professional courses or internships in US.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
So we've got actually just one more question remaining, so it'd be great if you can answer that. Is that for somebody with a computer engineering background, what are the different job options in supply chain?
You can do anything. Like I said, it doesn't matter if you are supply chain. I am myself an electrical engineer by education. Then I did my MBA from Institute of Rural Management, Anand. So rural management and electrical engineering, working in logistics and supply chain and heading a supply chain consultancy. So it doesn't matter. So if you are in computer science, if you really, it's because when you're studying, you think that what you have studied, you have to use it. It does not, typically you don't use it in a direct manner, but you end up using all that knowledge and skills in an indirect manner. So don't worry about how my supply chain, whatever I have studied in computer science, how is it going to use? For example, we have in our company, we have people who are studied electronics, who have studied IT, because we do a lot of analytics, and then we end up building small tools. So if there are computer science guys who have a little bent of good analytical skills, and have a little bent of, you know, some small time programming, VBA or kind of things, then we kind of make do small what you call report automations for our clients and all. So this is not high-end programming, but this is supply chain knowledge, doing supply chain engineering work, and then adding some programming skills to it for this thing. So even if you're a computer science graduate, there's nothing stops you from doing what we do today.
Okay, great. We need to first show the answers of the second poll.
Yeah. So I'm not surprised. E-commerce and FMCG, right?
Yeah.
So yes, consulting always comes in there, but third party logistics and transportation, 0-0. That's where my heart is. Okay. I worked for 15 years in third party logistics services and transportation, and now I'm heading a supply chain consultancy. So I'm saying that's the perception you have when you're 20 years behind, when we don't have this thing. We think that each of these jobs, so I didn't design it that way. It happened by default, doesn't matter. But I'm saying you have the advantage of the advice which you people can give. So if you're getting a chance in a third party logistics service company or a transportation, don't shy away from that, because I worked for 15 years and now here I am working as a CEO of a consulting company in supply chain. There are only two or three big supply chain consulting companies in India.
Okay.
And I'm working as a CEO. And my ability to work there comes solely from the fact that I'm a very highly operations oriented person, having worked for 15 years on the ground.
Okay.
So therefore, while FMCG and e-commerce is the in thing, FMCG is a what you call a greenfield thing. It'll always be, it's like mechanical or electrical subject, when you're choosing this thing.
Right.
So, third party logistics, transportation is the for the next. I'm thinking the industries of the next decade would be that, I would say.
Okay.
Along with e-commerce.
Okay, great. So that's some great advice. And actually, the one thing that in terms of giving any career advice to the viewers, the one thing that really stood out is that you were willing to get your hands dirty. That you were willing to pack boxes, you were willing to fill up the trucks. Because the best way you can learn, I guess, is by actually doing something.
Absolutely.
So you won't know the problems that are, say, faced by somebody who's working in a warehouse unless you actually do that activity yourself. So I think that's great. So thanks a lot, Ravikant, for coming here and giving this talk on the careers in supply chain management. I hope that the viewers have taken away some good insights from this particular webinar. And do also go and check out the Progress Group website. It's www.theprogressgroup.com in case you want to know more about them. And and we've also actually put up a webinar feedback form just below the video. So it would be amazing if you could just fill that up, and if you could send in what you feel about the webinar so that we can improve. So thanks a lot, Ravi, again for coming, and thanks a lot to all the viewers.
Thanks a lot to all the viewers. Thanks once again. Yeah.
Okay. Take care. Bye.